Ladies and gentlemen, my name is Red Bread. Welcome to the Space Monkey Mafia, where pants are the enemy. My thoughts are much collected. I'm doing very much better now. The high-pitched whine that I had to stop my stream for was because there is air in the water pipes. That I don't remember ever hearing. So that was like, what's going on? I thought it was a coil line from my computer because of how hot it was in my room and how hot it was outside. But no, everything's good now. My thoughts are collected. We are doing ranker lists of who are the top 10 space marines, who are the top 10 Legion or Chaos space marines, so on and so forth. Glad to be back. Glad to be streaming. As you can see, at number 18 is the Aurora chapter. Before I start, I know I might have been a little bit harsh with some of the things that I said last time. Too bad! My channel, my opinions, my thoughts. The Space Marine chapter known as the Ultramarines, though, of those guys, if you're making a top 10 list or top 20 list, they're always going to be number 10. And the reason for that is quite simple. They're predictable, they're unadaptable, and that is their biggest weakness. I do have a love-hate relationship with the Ultramarines. I think the Ultramarines are cool. I'm not going to go into the Mark Ward stuff. Nope, not going to do any of that. But basically, I have a love-hate relation with the Ultramarines. I do like some of the characters in the Ultramarine chapters. I think they have potential to be kind of cool, but they are just generic to me. They, from what I understand, they were created to be the jack of all trades. On the tabletop, not in the lore, and they were meant to be kind of be like a Astartes beginner army. The only real cool thing about them is they fought some bug boys, and I've got some neat gecko Roman themes going on. But anyway, enough about the Ultramarines. Let's dive in to this list. At 18. Voted with 648 votes is the Aurora chapter. I do not know who these guys are. Let's find out. The Aurora chapter is a loyalist chapter of Space Marines of disputed founding that is a successor chapter of the Ultramarines. Yes, the Ultramarines have a lot of successor chapters. The armory of the chapter boasts more predators and line raiders than any other than any three other Loyalist Space Marine chapters. Combined, they are thus specialized in mechanical armored assaults. I don't know where I got mechanical from. I was reading up there and my brain turned marine into mechanical. Okay, they've got an okay color scheme, nothing too fancy. I'm not sure what this is. It's an Aurora or like an 8. But anyway, like I said, I don't really know much about these guys, but they like heavy armored, they like their tanks. They like their predators, and they like their rain raiders. Okay. Who is next? Chapter 17. In 17, we have Angels Sanguine. The Angels are the Loyalist chapter of Space Marines and second founding successor chapter of the Blood Angels. Theirs is a long and glorious history, having been pivotal in many victories against the catacores that have emerged from the Eye of Terror. Yet the shadow of the Blood Angel's genetic flaw lingers ever about the Angels Sanguine. I know I'm probably mispronouncing that. What I like about this list is the other two lists that I went over today all had the exact same Space Marine chapters, and this one throws in some nice Space Marine chapters you don't really see a lot of, or people just forget about. Like, at 18, we've got these guys. I don't know who these guys are, but apparently 648 people did. These guys are cool. I don't know a whole lot about their founding or their lore. I really like the Flesh Terrors, though. Those are my boys. Alrighty. Going on up. Again, at 16, I've heard of these guys, don't know a lot about their lore. We have the Celestial Lions. The Celestial Lions are a loyalist space marine founded in the 38th millennium of unknown origins. The chapter has been long and glorious, has a long and glorious history, stretching back over 4,000 standard years. But in events set into motion two decades ago may now prove to be the chapter's undoing. What you guys do? Did you guys not, like, pay your internet bill? What's going on? What's going on? You guys not pay your bills? Go and get arrested by the Imperium for tax fraud? Like, what's going on? Ignore all this. Next, we have the number 15. We have the Howling Griffins. I like the Howling Griffins. I like all the Space Marine chapters that fought in the Bad Ebb War, especially the Carcharodons. The Carcharodons, I absolutely love. The Mantis Warriors, they got some boo-boos. I think they're done for, though. I think they've been kaput. Because there wasn't very many left of them at the end of the war. The Howling... as I'm choking on air. The Howling Griffins, or a loyalist space marine chapter founded in the 33rd millennium from the gene seed of the Ultramarines. Another Ultramarines gene seed, they do have Ultramarine gene seeds, but another Ultramarine successor chapter who fought in the Bad Ebb War and saw extensive action in the 13th Black Crusade, fighting against Chaos Plague Marines, or Death Guard. Well, I don't know if they would actually be Death Guard, because I'll get into that in a minute. In the defense of their world of Atimus Morgeris, the Howling Griffins take special pride in their oaths, seeing each as a promise of unending effort until the deed is sworn in. The oath is accomplished, or the oath... Oh, is sworn in, the oath is accomplished, or the oath taker has been slain. Try. So, I'm just gonna lower this a little bit so I can collect my thoughts. Let's go back here, back to this part. Chaos Plague Marines. So I don't know if that means just rando Plague Marines that are part of the Black Legion that aren't really part of Death Guard. They're just guys that were Space Marines that were in the Black Legion that pledged themselves to Nurgle and changed. And I'm not sure when this happened either, because I don't know a whole lot about their lore. It says in the 33rd. Okay. There's been a lot of Crusades going on too, Black Crusades. But in the book, The Lords of Silence, which is about the Death Guard and the group actually known as the Lord of Silence, you actually meet Mortarion in the book, and he basically says, do not go with Abaddon on his crusades. Abaddon and those who go with him, their time is up, basically. They'll get yeeted. Don't go with them. We've got other things we need to do. And from what I understand and what I know of the Death Guard, they are actually the most intact of the of the Chaos legions that got turned to bad guys. They are the most whole and unified among their brothers. Okay, Iron Hands, robot boys that are really, really angry. He's got like a, I don't know what that is going on, like a windshield wiper thing. Whoop 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 whoop. Anyway, the Iron Hands are loyalist space marines and one of the first founding space marine legions, created from the gene seed of their martyr primarch, Farius Manus. Although unwavering in their faith in the Emperor of Mankind and his dream of human unity is as embedded in the Imperium of Man, the Iron Hands also believe that human flesh is weak and easily corruptible, and strive to replace their organic bodies with more pure bionic substitutes, thus emulating the faith of the Adeptus Mechanicus, cult of the machine. When they step on Legos, it doesn't hurt them. These guys are pretty cool. I like them. They don't get a whole lot of love. They're very, very cool. They very, very don't much care about anything, so they'll blow it up, they'll kill it, melt it with plasma, blow it away with bolters. Crimson Fists. The Crimson Fists are a loyalist Space Marine chapter. They are the second founding chapter of the Imperial Fist Legion. The Crimson Fists are a chapter on the edge of extinction. Their fortress monastery destroyed and their numbers all but annihilated when the orc Warg Snagagrog descended on Loki's sector and their chapter homeworld of Rin's world. These guys are cool. I like them. I like their lore a lot. So usually they don't have two red hands. It's a specialty thing. Usually they're only going to have one hand that's red, and that is because of their oath. They cut their hands open and they make an oath. And, you know, their hand gets all bloody because I cut the palm of their hand open. And that's why they are blue and red. These guys are very, very cool. Back when I played Space Marine on the 360, I was part of a Crimson Fists nerd group. I had fun with it. I don't even know if that group's still around. They kind of disappeared. All right, then we have the White Scars. The White Scars are loyalist space marines and one of the first founding legions of the Adeptus Astartes. Known and feared throughout the Imperium of Man of their highly mobile way of war, the White Scars are considered the masters of lightning and strike and hit and run attack, and are particularly adapted to the use of the Astartes assault bike as their mechanical steed. I like these guys. They're born, literally born in saddles on their home world. I do like the David Bowie lightning bolt. And I said this in my last stream, but I had to cut this part out because, like I said, there was a high whining pitch noise that kind of ruined the stream. I thought it was my computer overheating. I really did. But then I found out it was just freaking air in our water pipes. So Jagatai Khan was one of the few Primarchs that actually could go toe-to-toe with Mortarion and not get, like, exhausted. Unfortunately, through bullshit hacks and plot armor, Jay Khan, I'll just call him that, ended up defeating Mortarion. Mortarion, though, was, from bullshit hacks, was basically his mental powers that he had been suppressing were starting to blossom, and they were basically killing him that he wasn't using them. Yes. I could go more into different stuff with the Primarchs and allegedly what the Chaos Gods, who they originally wanted but and who they ended up getting, but that's for another time, another day. I do like these guys. They're very cool. I very do much like them. They are based a lot around the Mongolian Empire and their history and stuff like that, so that's pretty cool. Then you have my boys, the best Warhammer Imperial Guard Regiment. See who's ranking number one. That's not who I'm doing. The Carcharodons. I love the Carcharodons. They were a very, very interesting chapter, and they had a very cool, important part in the Bad Ebb War. They're very unique, as they continue to grow to a certain point where they only really fit comfortably in Terminator armor. These guys are thought to be descendants of either Night Lords or Raven Guard or a Chimera of both, or just a unique Chimera gene seed. However, as I explained in my last stream, unfortunately, it's not up anymore. The Night Lord's gene seed is highly, highly pure and highly resistant to mutation and corruption of chaos. That is why when Night Lords start to mutate or get possessed by demons and start grilling icky bits and whatever, they're usually shunned by the other Night Lords they're with. Sometimes right out killed when it happens, other times put into suicide squads, and a lot of times those guys know that they're not going to be really welcome with their Night Lord brethren, so they'll break off and maybe in little war bands with each other, or they just yeet off into the night and join the Black Legion. But anyway, the chapter named the Carcharodon Astra, translated into Low Gothic as the Space Sharks. I still can't speak. But known widely God, but known more widely as the Carcharodons, is a space marine chapter of an unknown providence that has relatively recently carved out for itself a dark and brutal legend in the bloody wake of the Bad Ebb War. Yes, the poor space mantises. Mantis warriors.
They did not have a good time. They basically dropped the soap and these guys came up and said, pick it up, boy. And they're like, no, I don't think so. But they made them pick up the soap and then beat the hell out of them. Anyway.
Much of the information surrounding its history is shrouded in myth or allegory. But fragmented pieces of data point to it being in existence as early as late M32, during the Astropath Wars. One thing is for certain, however, the chapter was given a sacred duty to travel to empty spaces beyond the Imperium's border, seeking forever to seek out and destroy the enemies of mankind. These guys need to be, and I'm not trying to be biased with these guys because I like them, these guys need to be in the top 10, maybe 8 or 9. And the reason why I say that is because these guys have the rarest of rare technology from pre-Harris era. They got a lot of big ships. They got a lot of powerful weapons. They got a lot of stuff that very few, if any, other Space Marine chapters have. Raven God. The Raven God is one of the original Fist founding chapters at number 10. Of the Space Marines and was originally the Space Marine Legion before the XIX Space Marine before the Second Founding and the adaption of the Codex Astartes. The Primarch of the Raven Guard was Korax, a name which is an active play on the Latin word for Raven. The Raven Guard are known for their cool-headed, couldn't be one of these guys because I can't speak, intellectual temperament. Their superb infiltration skills and skills at furious close quarters engagement. These guys are cool. I like them. They sneak in and out. They like their jump packs. I don't know why they don't have a beaky here, because that is the armor that they prefer and like. They like the beaky armor, the Corvus armor. They're very, very sneaky. Sneaky boys. Very good at guerrilla warfare, hit and run stuff. But number 10 would have to be the Ultra Marines for me. Because, yes, they are very well organized. They are very well trained. They have lots and lots of recruits. They just would be number 10 for me on any list. But they would definitely not be in the top 5.
That is my opinion. Based on the facts and stuff that I've read about the Ultramarines, if you think the Ultramarine should be number 1, good for you. I'm not saying you're wrong, but in my opinion, you're wrong, because there's way more cooler chapters out there that can do what the Ultramarines do, but a little bit better, or maybe in a different way that makes them better.
Because like I said before, at the beginning of this, the Ultramarines do everything by the book, and in several pieces of the lore and books, they're always called predictable, and they always fall victim into the enemy's hands because the enemies are able to play them so well.
But anyway,
number 9 is the Death Watch. The Death Watch are their last resort, a chapter that serves the Ordo Xeno, the Inquisition or branch that focuses on aliens mostly. They're the last resort and can access firepower stronger than that of the Imperial Guards with their own acolytes and throne agents. They are the most informed of the other Space Marine chapters, even traitor ones. They execute missions where they mostly exterminate alien civilizations that threaten mankind.
Yeah, am I looping music? I am looping music.
That is alright. That is A-okay. We'll listen to this one last song. Death Watch is pretty cool. Death Watch, if you're very new to Warhammer 40K, they basically take the best of the best of the best from every chapter and they get put into the Death Watch. Sometimes it's a punishment, sometimes it's a reward, sometimes it's because their chapter has been completely destroyed and there's like maybe two or three guys left in that chapter. So these guys, like I said, these guys are pretty cool. 8, the Ultramarines. You guys already know my opinion about the Ultramarines and how I feel about them. The Ultramarines are considered one of the strongest and most honored of all Space Marines chapters in the Imperium of Men, and were responsible for single-handedly holding the Imperium together after the Horus Heresy. Highly disciplined, courageous warriors, the Ultramarines have remained true to the teachings of their Primarch Rubuta Gilliman for a very long time. The Ultramarines, like I said, they are what they are. I wouldn't say they are the strongest, though. Like I said, and I'm going to say it one last time, their biggest hindrance is they have to follow the teachings of their Primarch. And those who choose not to follow the Space Bible for Space Marines usually end up getting a pretty bad fate. They either get kicked out or killed, or they end up succeeding from the Ultramarines and then are branded as heretics while they form their own chapter. That has happened quite a bit. Number 7, the Imperial Fists. The Imperial Fists are pretty good. Pretty good. They are a solid 7, maybe 6. Well, it actually all depends. Like, if it's planetary defense, they're easily top 3. Because that is what they do. They are the last wall. They know what the hell they're doing. I don't know why I said top 3. They are number 1 in planetary defense. My brain is just...
Don't listen to me.
The Imperial Fists are one of the first founding Space Marine chapters that stand out from the other Space Marine chapters since they possess no fixed homeworld, although they are most frequently based on Terra. Instead of the Imperial Fists, rely on their really old 10,000-year-old mobile space fortress, the Phalanx, which is massive. It's huge. Served as their fortress monastery. They maintain recruitment chapels on various worlds spread throughout the Imperium. Part of the Imperial Fist duties during the Great Crusade were to function as the Emperor's personal praetorians, accompanying him everywhere. These guys are very, very good at defensive warfare. Salamanders. Salamanders are your buddy if you're humans and your world gets invaded, because they're one of the very few friendly guys that will actually help you out. You don't want the Black Templar coming, and if you know what I mean by that, good. If you don't know what I mean by that, go read Hell's Reach. In short, humans, at best for the Dark Black Templar, I don't know why, did I say Dark Templar? I don't know. Use them as bait. At worst, you're just in the way. Salamanders are one of the loyalist first founding chapters of the Space Marines. Their homeworld is a volcanic death world of Nocturne. The Salamanders, as a chapter, are usually concerned with the civilian casualties compared to most other Space Marine chapters. This is true. Most Space Marine chapters don't care about collateral damage, and believe that one of their most important duties is to protect the lives of the Emperor Mankind's innocent subjects whenever and wherever possible. These guys like their flame weapons. These guys are master craftsmen. Their stuff is very good, very well protected. There is no holes. There is no weak spots in their armor. So maybe I would put these guys at number 5. Dark Angels. The Dark Angels are considered among the most powerful and secretive of loyalist Space Marine chapters, and were the first of the original 20 Space Marine legions to be created during the first founding. Though they claim complete allegiance and service to the Emperor of Mankind, their actions and secret goals at times seem at odds with the professed loyalty. That's because some of these guys fell to the dark side, and they try to keep it a secret, and have been hunting down the heretics for a long time, and then the whole thing with the lion happened. So these guys these guys would definitely, the Dark Angels and the Black Templar are tied for number one for me. And the reason for that is these guys have pretty much the best weapons. They have the most plasma weapons. They have the most Terminators. They have a lot of stuff. And they're very good at what they do. But compared to the Dark Templars, these guys are a group of soccer moms in minivans, while the Dark Templar are a convoy of school buses, tour buses, pickup trucks full of people, double-decker buses. Like, they're a convoy of, let's get everybody into this big vehicle, shove them all in, and let's just keep getting more. But yes, so in my top three, it would, tied for number one would be Templar, Dark Templar. God, why do I keep calling them Dark Templar? Black Templar, Dark Angels, and the Carcharodons. And like I said, the reason why the Carcharodons would be so high is because, like the Dark Angels, they have really powerful technology and weapons that a lot of other chapters simply don't have. Four, the Grey Knights. Pretty broken on the tabletop. The Grey Knights are the mysterious loyalist chapters of the Marines, specifically tasked with combating dangerous demonic entities of the warp and all those who wield the corrupt power of the Chaos Gods. The Grey Knights act as a military arm of the Chamber Militant of the Ordo, Malleus. Malleus?
I don't know. I don't speak Latin.
The Demon Hunters, who form the oldest branch of the virtual omnipotent Imperial Inquisition. I do not like the Grey Knights for a couple of reasons.
You be quiet. We're going to go to a different playlist because this one has played its welcome out.
They will kill innocent people just to keep their identity a secret, and I don't like that. They've been called in to save worlds and then just been told by the Inquisition, you know, these people know who you are. It's time to get rid of them. And so it makes some of the stuff that they do just kind of pointless. What is this one? I don't know if this is going to match the Warhammer 40K thing, but it'll do for now.
It'll do for now.
Next up, number three, are the Space Wolves. So the other two articles that we did, it kept talking about how the Space Wolves were werewolves or they had werewolf powers. That's a bunch of malarkey. And I also think with the other two, allegedly, I don't know if it was written by the same lady or if the lady who did the article on Joy Ranker or Joy Rant, because there was one by Game Rant and there was one by Joy Rant. Maybe they're same by the own company, and maybe she was hired, or maybe they copied each other or one copied the other, but it was literally word for word some of the same stuff.
But anyway,
the Space Wolves are one of the original 21st founding Space Marine legions, and once led by their famed Primarch Leman Russ. After the Horus Heresy, and the resultant second founding reforms of the Adeptus Astartes, the Space Wolves Legion was divided into two chapters. The new Space Wolf chapter, which was not compliant with the dictates of the Codex Astartes, basically the Space Marine Bible, and retained the name of its parent Legion, and the second chapter, which took the name of the Wolf Brothers. I like these guys. I like Space Wolves for their Nordic culture. But unfortunately, the Nordic culture has been overlooked quite a lot. Unfortunately, now it's all about the Wolfen time, the Wolfen cookies, the Wolfen lemonade, the Wolfen parties, the Wolfen music, the Wolfen raves, the Wolfen cosplay. They just, too much with the wolves, man. Too much. Too much with the animals, too much with the wolves. Go back to your Nordic Nordic heritage thing, focus more on raiding and pillaging and plundering.
Become cool again. Anyway, Black Templars at number two.
The Black Templars, not the Dark Templars as I've been calling them, are a loyalist second founding Space Marine chapter, delivered from the Imperial Fist Gene Steed and their Primarch Rogal Don. Dorn. I always call him Don, but his name is Dorn. Their origin can be traced back to the Imperial Fist's defense of Terra during the Horus Heresy. Since that time, the Black Templars had been on the longest crusade of the Imperium of Man has ever known to prove their loyalty to the Emperor of Mankind. And they also basically told Buddha Gilliman to screw off with his space Bible. Dorn did. He said, "We're not a legion anymore. We're a crusade fleet. Go kiss my butt." And Gilliman was like, "Oh man. Okay, I guess." The Blood Angels at number one. This is an interesting choice. The Blood Angels are one of the 21st founding legions of the Space Marines. They are well known for their bloodthirsty nature in battle and feared for their cursed gene seed that they carry. I don't know a lot. I don't know that a lot of other Space Marines know about their flawed gene seed, or that they have the Red Thirst or the Black Rage. Because from what I understand, that's still kind of a big secret. Which leads me into my next point. Let me just get a drink of water, because my throat is dying and I'm dead. So, what we do know from the lore, now from the lore, is that Belius Krall, or however you say his name, didn't have access to all of the gene seeds from all the various different chapters out there. For example, the Minotaurs had their gene seed with them on their home planet. Belius Krall didn't have that because their gene seed is supposed to be secret. Along come the Death Guard, 7th Company, taint the gene seed bank, kill off most of the Minotaurs. The Minotaurs come crawling back in their broken down ships to Terra, and they get their first batch of Primaris. They were the very first chapter to get Primaris Marines. However, the first founding, the firstborn, I believe, of the Minotaurs are all dead, because they had those who lived had to sacrifice themselves so that their gene seed could live on. Which means certain chapters got ultramarine gene seed, or they got Nightlord gene seed. And the reason for that is ultramarines are the most common, but Nightlord gene seed is the hardest to corrupt. I think we've already talked about this, I think, and is the purest. And I think that the Flesh Terrors and the Blood Angels actually got Loyalist Night Seed. Loyalist Night Lords, not Night Seeds. God, the music's throwing me off because of my ADD. But I'm just going to stop this music so I can collect my freaking thoughts. All right. So I think the more violent chapters are the ones that have the Belius Krall were known to be a little bit more, brutal, got Loyalist Night Lord gene seeds in them. Because like I said, it is known that he didn't have all of the gene seeds to use. Because if he did, Gilliman would have found out about Sanguinius's curse and the bloodthirst and the Black Rage. Because that is something that I believe that is still a secret in the Blood Angels. For the Blood Angels. Now they did get, like I said, they did get Primaris Marines, Primaris Reinforcements. But my theory is they're probably, like I said, Loyalist Night Lords. Anyway, that's just my thing. Let's go up here, make sure. Okay, last time this gave away stuff, so Now we're going to go into the best Chaos Space Marine chapters, or Legionnaires. Close your eyes. Scroll down and start from the bottom. Whoa. Wow, there's only 8? All right. At 478, we have the Emperor's Children. The Emperor's Children really... You don't get a lot of representation on the battletop. Tabletop. Battletop. Tabletop. Same thing. The Emperor's Children is our traitor legion of the Chaos Space Marines who devote themselves solely to the service of the god, Chaos God Slaanesh, the Prince of Pleasure, also known as She Who Hungers. The Emperor's Children's Chaos Space Marines are known for possessing outlandish mutations, surgical alterations as gifts from Slaanesh, designed to make them more perfect in the eyes of their twisted patron. I'm surprised I don't have a picture of a Sound Marine here. These guys are very kind of gross. They're not what they once used to be, and a lot of them are now in smaller war bands. They're very, very gross. Number 7, the Black Legion. Wow. The Black Legion. Abaddon's boys. Okay. Kind of makes sense, though. The Black Legion is the traitor legion of Chaos Marines that is the first infamy, if not treachery, whose name resounds as a curse throughout the scattered war-torn realms of humanity. The Black Legion was once one of the first 9 founding legions in the Space Marines, whose traitor name to the Imperium during the Horus Heresy. Marines who turned traitor during the Horus Heresy in the 31st millennium. These guys were the sons of Horus. They were also the Lupercal Wolves. And now, they are Abaddon's little crybabies. I don't really like the Black Legion. I don't really care much for Abaddon. There's not much to say. Their time in the sun has passed. I know they're kind of the big baddies, but their time has gone. It's time for somebody else to go. And the reason why I said their time is gone is because, like I said in the Lords of Silence book, Mortarion actually had a vision that their time is coming up. Their time is coming to an end. Abaddon's role is pretty much used up. He is losing favors with the gods, and somebody else is going to replace him soon. I don't know if they'll ever do that in the tabletop. If they do, they probably won't get rid of Abaddon. The Black Legion will just probably be put on a back burner, and maybe there'll be different warbands of the Black Legion, and then maybe there'll be like a new legion, like, I don't know, a new legion of Horus. Number 6, the Iron Warriors. The Iron Warriors' specialty was breaking the sieges and assaults on static fortifications, which made them the great rivals of the Imperial Fist Legion, which was said to construct the greatest static defenses in the Imperium. It is a rival between the legions and between their Primarchs, Protorabo, and the Imperial Fist Roldan that helped turn the Iron Warriors to chaos. Iron within, iron without. So these guys are basically the chaos equivalents of not only the Imperial Fists, but also the Iron Warriors. Or not, these guys are the Iron Warriors, the Iron Hands, because basically any part that gets grossly mutated, they lop off and replace with robotic parts. You can see that there with his leg, and maybe with his arm there. Maybe that's just regular armor, but they also think that the flesh is weak, and these guys have really high attrition rates. I could go into the grafted. Those guys are pretty cool. I probably will, because it's a fun little lore fact that people don't know about. So they were first mentioned in a Space Marine Anubis that I have, or Omnibus, whatever, that was written by Graham McNeil. Basically, 2 Ultramarines are sent away on a suicide quest because one of them decided to join the Death Guard and fend off, not the Death Guard, the Death Watch, to help fend off some Tyranids that were coming to eat McCrag, eat them all up. And they basically, because he disobeyed orders and he didn't follow the space Bible, he and his buddy got kicked out to go on the suicide quest. Long story short, they came across and got captured by the Iron Warriors. Hopefully I'm getting this information right, because it's been years since I've read that book. But essentially, to make up for their attrition rates, they basically have these things called demon wounds, with wombs, not wounds, that they got from Slaanesh somehow. And they started growing basically clones, but without skin. You take a prisoner of war, strip them of their power armor, throw them in the demon thingy. The demon thingy would basically dissolve you down back to basic material. And sometimes your gene seed would be left over, so they could pluck out, the apothecary could pluck out the gene seed and reuse it. And then over time, a new space marine clone would be born, most of the times without skin. And in the book, the Iron Warriors didn't really like that and thought that was kind of gross, so they threw them down a giant garbage shaft. And then these two marines that were put in the womb, the ultramarines, they escaped. They cut open the wombs. They got out. They ripped out. They found these, the grafted, these ugly, gross, skinless guys who didn't know what the hell was going on. They're like, you are now loyalists. And they used them to get out the hell out of Dodge, but they all died. And everybody thought that was the end of them. But no, they're still using them. Basically, they stopped throwing them down garbage chutes and realized that these guys, because they're in so much pain and because they don't have any skin, they can just graft them into power armor. And if they get shot or hurt, like, to them, that's just like, it's, that's not pain. That's just, okay, whatever. And they keep going on. And I think they use that lore to, and this is just me spitballing and speculating here, and I could be wrong. I think they use that lore for the, or maybe have used it to be the inspiration behind the new Obliterator models. Because those guys are kind of mutated and grafted into their weaponry and stuff like that. So maybe that's where they got it. But I do know the grafted are still around, and I do know there's a couple of other Iron Warrior, if I can speak, warbands out there that clone their Astartes to make up for their high attrition rate. The Night Lords at number 5. Ooh. Like I said, no, I said that in the first one. So I haven't read any of these, so this is a new surprise. I do like the Night Lords. The Night Lords are my boys. I know people don't like them. I do. I like them a lot. And the Night Lords do not worship any of the Chaos Gods individually, that is true, but acknowledge them equally in the form of Chaos Undivided, as they ruthlessly spread terror and fear amongst the galaxy's inhabitants. The Night Lords are expert in the use of terror tactics to win battles and demoralize their foes before their main combat even begins. These guys are Murder Batmans, or a hybrid of Murder Batman and Judge Dredd. They are the law. If you litter, you will be skinned alive. I do like these guys. They are neat. They're cool. I like the stories about them. Right now, I am halfway through the second book. It's been a while. The only time I find myself reading the book is when the house loses power, which is a sad thing. I'll probably have to go dig it out and reread it. But these guys are cool. Their power armor, I don't think they had the lightning bolts in the Horus Heresy, but their power armor is special. That is not painted on. Lightning actually does crackle off their armor. It crackles and dances off their armor, which gives it a really, really cool and special effect. The Alpha Legion at number 4. There's not a whole lot of votes that I'm knowing with the Chaos Legionnaires. There were a bunch, though, with the regular ones, with the Loyalists.
Because Chaos doesn't get very much love, nor does Xenos or Orcs, but that's a tale for another time.
The Alpha Legion is the Chaos Legion, Marine Trader Legion, about whom the least is known. They are experts in infiltration. Their armies contain many Chaos cultists in addition to regular Chaos Space Marines. These guys are like your evil James Bond mixed with Hydra from the Avengers? Hail Hydra? Yeah.
Thousand Sons.
All these poor guys. This dude right here, he can't take off his helmet or his power armor because he's just dust.
The main features that distinguish the Thousand Sons from other Trajan legions is their sheer numbers of psychic mutations that have always existed amongst the Space Marines in this legion. Currently, every member of the legion possesses psychic abilities.
Yes, every one of them can use mind bullets. Every current member of the legion is... Yep. They prefer the use of Chaos Space Sorcerers in guile and combat, relying on their psychic powers and their sorcerer's knowledge to earn them victory. These guys used to be red and gold. Now they are blue and gold. And the reason why they're blue is because of Tryaind. Death Guard. Ooh, Death Guard's not number one. You're having a bad time if the Death Guard step on your doorstep. Because even if they just do decide to leave, or you somehow are able to stop them, just like the orcs, there's going to be permanent side effects to the planet you're on, mainly in disease and happy little creatures called nurglings and weird plague plants and God knows what else. But let's get into the Death Guard. I do like that the Death Guard. I do like Mortarion. My favorite Chaos Legions are in no particular order: the Death Guard, Night Lords. And I do like the World Eaters. But anyway, the Death Guard are one of the traitor legions of the Chaos Space Marines. They worship and devote themselves exclusively to the Chaos God Nurgle. As a result of his mutational gifts, they have become Plague Marines, Astartes who are eternally rotting away within the power armor, and infect with every known form of disease and decay. But who are immune to all the pain or minor injury. In 8th edition, these guys could eat a las cannon to the face and be okay with it. Their armor does rot away, but it also becomes more organic over time. So they become really gross living abominations of flesh, sinew, and whatever the hell their armor becomes. Oh my god. World Eaters are number one. They are the most brutal. And they are the Khorne Berserkers pretty much in 8th edition. You get those guys in a rhino, and if the rhino survives, then you deploy them. And I've actually seen this happen on a couple of different YouTube channels where people were playing the tabletop game, and they had two groups of Khorne Berserkers in... basically rhino case space, the rhino equivalent of for space evil space marines attacking knights, and the rhinos survived, and both groups of marines were able to get out and get lucky enough not to get killed in Overwatch and just in one turn take down an imperial knight. Anyway, the World Eaters are dedicated servants to the god Blood God of Khorne, the Chaos God of War and Murder, and live for nothing more to spill the blood in his name. The World Eater's Primarch, Angron, was one of the first Space Marine Primarchs to join the War Master Horus when he turned against the Emperor and began the Horus Heresy. So, as a Chaos God, Khorne is unique because not only does he get his power from just death, destruction, and war, but from what I've seen, he's one of the few gods that will actually resurrect dead people and bring them back to life to fight another day. He's done this a couple of times with... He's done this over and over and over again. Sorry. With orcs and some demons. He has them constantly fighting and killing each other every day. And the outcome always changes. Sometimes the orcs win. Sometimes the demons win. Sometimes no one wins, and he just resurrects them all the time. But he's done that too with with his with some of his corn berserkers and things like that. Anyway, so I was very surprised they had world leaders as number one. I thought maybe Black Legion, they would have Black Legion as number one. All right, what else do we have here? We have best craft worlds, best orc clans, best Tyranid hives, best Imperial gun regiment, guard regiment, not gun regiment, greatest raise, and every 40K game ranked. We'll do Tyranids just because with 10th edition coming up, there are going to be people interested about Tyranids. I don't know a whole lot about Tyranids except for they are giant space bugs of murder and death, and they eat everything, and then they go on to the next planet and start over again. Their numbers are countless. Alright. High Fleet Leviathan is at number one. High Fleet Leviathan was the third and largest Tyranid incursion into the Milky Way galaxy in 997, or M41, and marked the start of the ongoing Third Tyrannic War for the Imperium of Mankind. Less than 5 years after the defeat of High Fleet Kraken in the Second Tyrannic War, Lord Inquisitor Cryptman noted the telltale signs of yet another Tyranid invasion in 997. M41. He implanted the Cryptman census, burning out dozens of astropaths. That's not good. An attempt to contact scores of worlds on every fringe of the Imperium. Slowly, the responses and the lack of them formed a pattern, and the venerable Inquisitor was able to chart the course of the Tyranid's latest high fleet to arrive in the Milky Galaxy. These guys have the icky purple and flesh tone colors. Like I said, I don't know much about them. I'm not a Tyranid player. I don't really have a Tyranid codex. I was going to do a Tyranid kill team just because I like killer space bugs. 2. Hive Fleet Behemoth. Hive Fleet Behemoth was the first major Tyranid Hive Fleet encountered and defeated by the Imperium of Man. The ensuing conflict became known as the First Tyrannical War. The High Fleet was eventually destroyed in 745 by the combined might of the Ultramarines, the White Scars, and the Imperial Navy. These guys are kind of cool looking. Black and red.
High Fleet Kraken! High Fleet Kraken was the second major Tyranid High Fleet to invade the galaxy. It was responsible for the outbreak of the Second War, which began officially in 992 and ended only after the Ultramarines chapter of Space Marines successfully broke the back of the Tyranid invasion. Imperial space at the Battle of Ikar, is that 4 or 5, and the Eldar craft world Eidolon successfully defended their home at the great cost against the Tyranid horde.
Okay. Do not know if these guys were in the whatchamacallit games, Dawn of War games with the Blood Ravens. I do know the Exorcists actually fought some of these guys. I watched a video on other non-Ultramarine Space Marine chapters that fought in the wars, and there's some quite interesting ones that were a part of it. And at number 4, we have Hive Fleet Dragon. Oh, those guys are having a bad day. High Fleet... Oh, Dagon, not Dragon.
Oh, man. This guy really likes to read his H.P. Lovecraft. Because why... You know who Dagon is.
High Fleet Dagon was the first major Tyranid incursion into the Jericho Reach region of the Ultima Segmentum. The shadow of the warp cast by the Tyranid hive mind within this violent region of space first heralded the arrival of the new terrible High Fleet in 812. So these guys are psychics. They're more psychic than the other ones, but all of them are kind of psychic, though. That's very interesting to note. Newt. communication between the Achilles Crusade and the considered regions of Jericho Reach were all lost without warning. Practically, if the effect of the was the Orpheus assailant of the Crusade that was lost to communication and access to the reach of okay. So these guys use the warp to their advantage. Chaos demons and chaos gods don't like the Tyranids because they can't harvest their souls. And last but not least, at number 5, we have High Fleet Gorgon. High Fleet Gorgon was a Tyranid fleet which invaded the Tau Empire in 899. Gorgon was a splinter fleet of High Fleet Behemoth that was founded by those Tyranids who had survived Behemoth's destructions during the Battle of Macrag, and which began consuming poorly defended Imperial worlds to replenish their small numbers. By the time the splinter fleet made its way to Tau space in the eastern fringe of the galaxy, it had grown to become a full High Fleet of its own right. That is interesting. The Tau ended up helping create new Tyranids by fighting them, which is a shame that they all didn't get eaten.
But anyway,
I kind of like the Tau. They're interesting. I like all the factions of Warhammer 40K. They're all interesting. They're all in their own rights. Alrighty. We'll go with every 40K game ranked.
What? Go away, Ad.
At number one, we have Dawn of War, Warhammer 40,000. So originally, it was the Blood Ravens who were supposed to be the poster boys of Games Workshop and not the Ultramarines. Number two, we have Warhammer 40,000. That is a very, very good game. Not a whole lot of votes going on here either, huh? Number three is Dawn of War 2. I would actually put Dawn of War 2 maybe above Warhammer, the first one, Dawn of War. I mean, Dawn of War is pretty good, but Dawn of War 2 was so good, in fact, that Blizzard kind of ripped off, allegedly, I'm going to put that out there to save my butt, the way the game works for StarCraft 2. At number 4, we have the expansion pack for Dawn of War 2, which is Dawn of War 2 Chaos Rising. At number 5, we have Warhammer 40,000 Mechanicus. I never played that game. It's supposed to be like an XCOM game. Number 6, we have... What's going on here? Go away. I don't know what you are. We have Inquisitor Martyr. That is a pretty neat game. I do like that game. And number 7 is Battlefleet Gothic Armada 2. Okay. Interesting. At number 8, we have Dawn of War 2, Retribution. At 9, we have Space Hulk Deathwing. That's a very good game. Unfortunately, the bad thing about that game is I don't think anybody really plays that anymore, and it did come out in 2016. Another issue that I had with the game that I wanted to make a video on a long, long time ago is people don't understand that it's based on a board game, and so you have to take board game tactics to the game, and if you just try to go gung-ho on your own, your whole team, your whole squad is going to have a bad time. At number 10, 1993 Space Hulk. And at number 11, we have Warhammer 40,000 Chaos Gate. 1998. Huh. But the new Chaos Gate isn't on there. That's interesting. That is very interesting.
Very cool.
Oh, it still goes on. Never mind. At number 12, we have Warhammer 40,000. No. No, 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 no. That was an on-rail shooter mobile game. That was horrible. No. At number 13 is Space Hulk 23. No. Get this off the list. Get this off the list. At number 14 is Warhammer 40,000 Fire Warrior. All right, I've never played that. I heard mixed things about it. At number 15, we have Warhammer 40,000 Relics of War Gladius. I heard bad things about this game, too. At number 16, we have Warhammer 40,000 Inquisitor Prophecy, which is interesting. At 17, which I don't know why this is not higher up on the list, is Battlefleet Gothic Armada, which was the first game. It was very good. At 18, we have Final Liberation, which came out in 1997 for Microsoft Windows. Ooh, this is the game I was talking about. At number 19, we have the Warhammer 40,000 Death Watch Tyranid Invasion. This game, I really wish this game was not a mobile game, and I really wish some more stuff was put into it. It is a interesting game in the aspects of the banter, but everything else is just kind of meh, and it gets boring. At number 20, we have Kill Team. Kill Team is actually a very good game that came out for the 360. I don't know if that ever came out. It also came out for Microsoft Windows, but I wonder if they have it on Steam. I doubt it, though. This was a twin-stick shooter game. It came out a little bit right before Warhammer 40,000 Space Marine. And if you played this game or bought this game, you got a special weapon, which was just a power sword, for the multiplayer in Space Marine. Warhammer 40,000 Squad Command 2007. Okay, Nintendo DS, PlayStation Portable. Huh, I've never heard of that before. Number 22 is Space Hulk Tactics. Alrighty, that should be kind of upper on the list. And number 23 is Space Crusade, January 1st of 1992. Ooh, that's an old one. At number 24, maybe it was Armageddon that was bad. Warhammer 40,000 Armageddon turn-based strategy. Okay, number 25 is Dawn of War 3. Dawn of War 3. Oof. I've heard nothing but bad things about that game, but I picked it up because it was on sale and I wanted to try my hand on it. At number 26, Warhammer 40,000 Rites of War. Dreamforge, turn-based role-playing game, Microsoft Windows. Okay. And at number 27, we have Space Hulk, Vengeance of the Blood Angels, key game. 3DO Interactive, DOS, Sega Saturn, personalized computer, and PlayStation game. Very interesting. Very interesting. I've seen this one at a handful of... Uh-oh. I will look at that later. I've seen a handful of these at, like, used media game places, and the prices for this game are ridiculous. At 28, we have Warhammer Eternal Crusade. This game is dead. You can no longer play it. So sad. I never got to play it because at the time, even the bestest of computers had a hard time playing with it. It never was truly finished and kind of got abandoned. And it basically had its own little downfall. It never came out on PlayStation 4, buddy, or Xbox One, or Linux. It was only on Steam. This game never came out on any of the consoles. At 29, we have Warhammer Space Wolf, which is another mobile game. At number 30, we have Horus Heresy Drop Assault, another mobile game. At turn-based strategy, engage. So what is this? We have Warhammer 40,000 Glory and Death, which came out in 2006 for platform engage. I don't know what that is. At 32, we have Warhammer 40,000 Carnage, Roadhouse Studio, action role-playing game. Okay, another mobile game. 33 is Sanctus Reach, which is a mobile game. 34 is Eisenhorn Xenos, which is a mobile game, but it is very well it's very well voice acted. Citadel Combat Cards, that doesn't really count as a game. It's a collectible card game. Horus Heresy Legions at 36. At 37, we have Warhammer 40,000 Storm of Vengeance. Another freaking mobile game. this game I wanted to play, and I was going to sign up for it, and I just kept forgetting about it, and I never was able to. This game you can no longer get, Warhammer 40,000 Regicide, which is like chess. And at 39, we have Space Hulk Ascension. All right. At 40, Legacy of Dorne, Herald of Oblivion, Adventure RPG. Huh. 41, we have Battle Fleet Gothic Leviathan. 42, we have Talisman Horus Heresy. And last but not least, at 43, we have the Horus Heresy Battle of Tanar. Why? I'm curious why I'm very, very curious why the Necromunda game isn't the Necromunda games aren't on there. That's very interesting. Very, very interesting. Because I did like Necromunda Hired Gun. And Chaos Gate, the original, the new Chaos Gate is on there, which is very, very interesting. Very, very interesting. Maybe for a later stream, I will cover best Eldar Craft Worlds and best Orc Clans and best Imperial Regiment. And then for lasties, I'll do the Greatest Race.
Yay!
But I wanted to go over that because earlier, like I said, there was this really high whine pitch that I kept hearing that my mic kept picking up. It was very, very loud. I thought it was a coil whine from my PC. No, it was just air in the water pipes. Air in the water pipes. But I had fun doing this. I hope those of you who joined in had a fun time. Had a good time seeing this. We're actually just going to go to chatting real quick. Let's see here. Yeah, we're just going to kaboot that.
We're just going to kaboot that.
I will be going back to playing games and things like that. I was going to play some other games earlier, but it's been so hot that sitting here, I'm just sweating. I'm all gross and mucusy. I'm turning into a Nurgle boy. But ladies and gentlemen, my name is Dreadbread. It has been great fun doing this. My gameplay videos aren't doing well, which I knew was going to be the case, but that's all right. You know, I enjoy playing video games. I enjoy Warhammer 40K. And that's okay that my other stuff hasn't done really well. That's just fine with me. I'm just a little guy who does this as a hobby. I don't get paid to do it. I like having fun. I like hanging out, talking to you guys. Hopefully you guys found this VOD joyful. If not, give it a thumbs down. Tell me why you didn't like it, at least. And I'll try to do better next time. Anyway,
bye-bye. Have a good day. And if you like Ultramarines, you're stinky. You're a stinky boy or girl. Just very stinky. And you need to go shower because we all know the Space Marines are just very stinky. Anyway. Bye-bye.